We'll show up.
Sit down. Right, so I'd like to formally introduce Hannah. I think everybody's here now. And Hannah is going to speak to us about an aspect that I find particularly interesting, about the relationship between machine language, writing, and transcendental computers. So thank you very much, Hannah.
Thank you, Sheena. So I don't have a lot of visuals today. I thought I would perform this by way of my voice alone, and my voice doesn't seem to be performing to its optimal today, so I apologise in advance for the number of times I'm going to clear my throat, of course, of this talk. Anyway, my aim in this paper is to articulate a way of thinking about what language is, which releases it from certain philosophical presuppositions about the subject of speech. The call for this conference suggested that philosophical discourses tend to assume that language is something produced by human beings. I would agree with this view, that this has been dominant in continental philosophy, at least since the Enlightenment, although there are obviously some exceptions. My approach to the question of how the development of speaking machines affects our understanding of where meaning resides in language is to propose a notion of machine language. I'm using this term to indicate any systematically coordinated communicative expression that originates at the exterior of human consciousness. So it includes words that are generated by a computer, but it might equally emerge out of human interaction or the actions of other non-human actors. My reason for proposing a speaking machine in this way is that I aim to propose a way of thinking about the experience of language, which frees it from any reliance upon substantive notions of human subjectivity. My approach is informed by François Laruelle's discussion of artificial intelligence and automatic thought in his 2005 essay, The Transcendental Computer. Laruelle has developed a theoretical posture that he calls non-philosophy, which entails a global analysis of the formal structure of legitimation that underwrites philosophical reasoning, and, in the same gesture, as it were, a positive revisioning of philosophy's concepts according to a different syntactic logic, a different transcendental logic, if you like, which he calls scientific. The term transcendental computer names an abstract theoretical apparatus that's constructed in order to effectuate this new, more imminent mode of viewing language. Ultimately, my aim here is to sketch out such an apparatus. Laruelle states that, quote, philosophy postulates that every use of language is a use with a view to the logos, language being taken as constitutive of the being of things, end quote. And I argue that in order to rigorously theorise a non-human subject of speech, it's necessary to decouple language from this philosophical logos, which is what Laruelle's non-philosophical method proposes to do. Laruelle's claim about the philosophical conception of language is based on an extensive formal analysis of the structure of philosophy as such, which he characterises as a self-perpetuating and auto-constituting circle. However, because his theory is complex, highly abstract, and saturated with really impenetrable jargon, rather than bore you with rehearsing this critical analysis, I'm instead going to assume that it's correct and then experiment with articulating non-philosophy's positive vision through a discussion of two examples of machinic language production. The first is the collective writing machine created by Ron Athey in his performance piece from 2010, Gifts of the Spirit, Automatic Writing, Part 1. The second is the abstract machine that Alan Turing proposed in his 1950 paper, Computing Machinery and Intelligence. Each example proposes a mechanism for generating language exterior to any substantive subjective consciousness, but I will argue that both these mechanisms ultimately still index the human as the originator of linguistic meaning. Each example is framed by a different discursive logic, one theatrical, the other scientific. But as we shall see, each example offers an understanding of language that's implicitly grounded in its performance. I will conclude by proposing a non-philosophical way of viewing both practices in one, using them as models for a transcendental computer. The result is a radicalised conception of performativity, which estranges the speaking subject from both the humanistic presuppositions of philosophy and the mathematical presuppositions of computer science, allowing us to view the act of language in a radically non-humanist manner. Thus, by outlining the notion of the transcendental computer, I propose a theoretical apparatus for thinking what artificial intelligence might be and how it might be understood to speak.
First, let's look at AC's Gifts of the Spirit. Like much of AC's work, it's an autobiographical piece, although one that is in some ways untypical of his oeuvre, which largely consists of what is sometimes called extreme body art. Previous pieces, such as Four Scenes in a Harsh Life from 1994, Deliverance from 1997, and Joyce from 2002, have dealt with similar aspects of AC's life story. However, as Lisa Newman notes, whilst, quote, these performances were often presented in a blur of spectacle, physical wounding, camp, and allusions to martyrdom, end quote, Gifts of the Spirit was noticeably different because of, quote, the lack of emphasis on AC's own physicality and the absence of the social politics surrounding queer sexuality and AIDS, end quote. So I'm just going to show you a short video documenting the piece so you get a sense of what it looks like, and then I'll explain in more detail what's happening and how it constitutes a machine in mode of writing. Try and find that anyway. So the piece has a large piece of paper on the floor in the shape of a cross. It's covering much of the floor, and a number of writers are sat upon the paper engaged in a practice of automatic writing, by which I mean writing whatever comes into their heads for certain strictly delimited periods of time. I thought this was going to be so simple. I was like, no PowerPoint, I'm just going to play one minute long video. Don't worry, I'm just going to carry on talking now because you've got a little look at what it looks like anyway. So, we've got writers on this huge cross-shaped piece of paper. They're automatic writing. A second group of performers play the role of editor. They look at the text produced by the writers and select bits, which they cut out with scissors, and put up on the wall before a third group of performers, the typists. The typists select lines from the excerpts they're given, transcribe them using old-fashioned typewriters. The editors then take the pages produced by the typists, once again make cuts, and combine the lines they've selected on sheets of paper. These sheets are then taken to Athey, and in the version of the performers I saw, which is not actually this one, a second speaker who read them out to the audience. Athey himself refers to this collective setup as a machine. The writing process is organised by a set of rules, with each group of actants having a distinct function, and clear protocols delimit the activities they perform and coordinate the actions of the various machinic parts. Within the limits set out by these protocols, the individual writers have the freedom to write what they will, and the editors and typists to select and order the text produced by the writers according to their own judgment. This introduces a degree of randomness to the process. The rules of the system ensure that between writers, editors, and typists, no one individual has more influence than the others over the final output. Yet, as Athey says, quote, I think they tapped into each other and developed a rhythm of their own, end quote. And this was enhanced by the fact that all the performers underwent group hypnosis prior to the performance. Different parts of the machine work simultaneously to generate the text. At intervals during the performance, Athey counts down. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And he sets them off to commence their actions. He then stops them again after a period of time. Thus we get a sense of the machine being switched on and off using the voice. At a sensuous level, the rhythmically irregular mechanical sound of the antique typewriters clack, clack, clacking adds to this feeling that one is watching a machine in action. Athey says that he, quote, wrote the movements of automatic writing out as a sound score graph rather than a script. This is the first time he viewed a piece in this way. And the score could be seen in computational terms as a kind of programme. The machinic action of the piece is punctuated by AC's narration, which consists of excerpts from his as yet unfinished autobiography, and which helps the audience to make sense of the machinic language setup. Athey grew up in a Pentecostal community where he was trained as a psychic and groomed for ministry as a child. He says, quote, "While I did receive the gift of speaking in tongues, I failed at automatic writing." Athey renounced formal religion in his teens, but remains interested in the ecstatic states he experienced as a member of this religious culture, sometimes describing himself as a mystical atheist. In much of his body art, he accesses the ecstatic by subjecting himself to torturous physical experiences. Gifts of the Spirit constructs a very different kind of ecstasis. What it does is to externalise the process of language production from Athey's subjective consciousness, delegating it to the collective writing machine. By materially performing an impersonal process of language generation, I would suggest it constitutes a challenge to the substantive interiority of the philosophical subject. While the writers, editors, and typists each have a role in generating a text, the speakers enunciate the text as it's given to them. So they perform the function of translating it from written to a spoken medium in what we might think of as a fully automatic fashion, much as a DVD player translates digital code into audiovisual signals. It doesn't make a decision to make a choice about what it does. In this sense, Athey has constructed a mechanism for introducing a certain systematic randomness, a mode of chance composition, into his otherwise autobiographical piece. He states that, quote, "The impulse was to depersonalise the memoir text so as to reiterate it, but run it through a colder process," end quote. And he did this by utilising what he calls the collective unconscious that hypnosis enabled the performers to access. What's important for our purposes is how the spoken text of the performance alternates between the subjectively generated memoir and the impersonally generated language of the automatic writing machine. And in this way, it sets two modalities of language production into relation so as to effectively produce a new sense for both. I want to suggest that the way Athey places the two different modes of language together, allowing them to be seen as two aspects of the same performance, sharing an identity somehow without necessarily being similar to each other, is in some ways analogous to a material enactment of a non-philosophical revisioning of language. I will return to this, but first I will turn to Alan Turing. In Computing, Machinery and Intelligence, Turing proposes to consider the question, can machines think? He observes that, quote, "This should begin with the definition of the meaning of the terms machine and end quote. However, having remarked on how ambiguous these terms are in their common usage, Turing instead proposes a game which he calls the imitation game. This entails an interrogator posing questions to two entities whom he or she cannot see. One of these is human, one is a digital computer. And the interrogator must make a judgment as to which is which on the basis of the answers provided. For the sake of scientific rigour, the test would be repeated many times with different interrogators. Turing proposes that, quote, "The question, can machines think, should be replaced by, are there imaginable digital computers which would do well in the imitation game?" End quote. He thereby implies that a computer which succeeded with some consistency at this game could be considered a thinking machine. Turing considers a somewhat woolly question, can machines think, to be, quote, "too meaningless to deserve discussion," end quote. He proposes the imitation game, which came to be known as the Turing test, has advantages over the original question in as much as the game conforms to certain standards expected of a scientific test, having strict parameters and being repeatable. Turing also observes that, quote, "the new problem has the advantage of drawing a fairly sharp line between the physical and the intellectual capacities of a man," end quote. This suggests a disembodied understanding of thinking or intelligence, which is identified with software rather than hardware. This focus on software is emphasised by the fact that Turing largely disregards actually existing computers, which in 1950 weren't that sophisticated, instead proposing what he calls, quote, "abstract machines," end quote, that hypothetically could pass the test. He describes such abstract machines as, quote, "mathematical fictions rather than physical objects." These fictitious machines are mathematical because they're abstract models that are represented through a mathematical language. Such representations, and indeed the digital machines to which they refer, are made possible by a mode of logic which begins by breaking a computational system down into its smallest discrete parts. Turing identifies the basic functions of a computational machine: storage, execution, and control. At that time, the term computer was still commonly used to refer to a person who performs calculations. So he demonstrates the logic of the discrete machine by analogy with a human computer. He then proposes that by increasing the quantity of storage and processing capacity and building up the complexity of the system by adding more layers of commands, it's hypothetically possible to construct a machine that could learn and hence to evolve. This notion of learning is important here because it allows Turing to overturn the objection to the idea of a thinking machine made by Ada Lovelace in 1842 in relation to Charles Babbage's analytic engine. Namely, quote, "The analytical engine has no pretensions to originate anything. It can do whatever we know how to order it to perform," end quote. By breaking down the computational mechanism in the way he does, Turing effectively explains the rudiments of programming to a non-expert audience and sketches out the principles for a virtual machine that could learn in the manner of a conditioned reflex, and which could thus learn, theoretically, to pass as human in the imitation game. He conjectures that by the end of the 20th century, such machines will exist. And whilst this prediction may not have exactly come to pass, I would suggest that current developments in AI, where the kind of learning machines he outlined are very much a reality, demonstrate that he was, in some ways, fairly close to the mark. Yet, and more importantly for our purposes, his displacement of the question, "Can machines think?" by the question, "Can machines pass the imitation game?" carries with it a set of implications concerning what it means to think, and by extension, to speak, which can be seen as a challenge to the philosophically grounded notion of the speaking subject. Turing addresses a number of objections to his argument. One is that machines might be said to, quote, "carry out something which ought to be described as thinking, but which is very different from what a man does," end quote. He acknowledges that this is a strong objection, but suggests that, quote, "if a machine can be constructed to play the imitation game satisfactorily, we need not be troubled by it," end quote. Thus, he disregards the process through which language is generated, instead making the machine's output the sole criterion for judging whether it has effectively imitated a human, and thus whether thinking has occurred. In this way, he identifies thought with the pragmatic performance of language rather than with experience. This allows Turing to dismiss a number of other objections to his proposition that imaginable machines could think. These include the theological notion that thinking is a function of the immortal soul, the philosophical notion that thinking belongs to a subjective consciousness, and the idea that there's a qualitative difference between the processes of discrete state of digital machines and the continuity of the human nervous system. He states, quote, "I believe that at the end of the century, the use of words and general educated opinion will have altered so much that one will be able to speak of machines thinking without expecting to be contradicted." I was going to deviate into thinking about digital ontology, but I'm going to skip over that bit for the sake of time. So, what I want to do now is to relate this potential shift in how we understand the terms thinking and machines to John McKenzie's general theory of performance. McKenzie, writing at the turn of this century, suggested a shift in discursive formation is occurring from the disciplinary society identified by Michel Foucault to a performative society, one in which subjects are compelled to respond to the imperative, perform or else. He identifies three distinct paradigms in which the term performance is increasingly deployed in contemporary culture, and his claim about this discursive shift is premised on an analysis of how these paradigms together constitute a complex, contested, but increasingly powerful discourse. McKenzie's first performance paradigm is what he calls organisational performance. This names the performance demanded of workers, corporations, etc. It can be thought of as a way of understanding the intrinsically competitive nature of the neoliberal economy. This paradigm is the least relevant to us, so I won't dwell on it for long. The second paradigm, McKenzie calls cultural performance. In this context, he posits performance as a subversive or resistant practice concerned with liminality and challenging societal norms. Athey's theatrical work in general fits very much into this category. Given that what we're talking about here is discursive formations, then so too does the whole field of performance theory, and also theories of performativity that emerge out of J.L. Austin's ordinary language philosophy in the 1950s and are redeployed in the broader context of cultural theory from the 1990s onwards following Judith Butler's performative theory of gender. Hence, as a theoretical notion, performance comes to be explicitly related to language through its close relation to performativity. And I wasn't really thinking about Wittgenstein when I read this, but I think the earlier paper that was written, this Wittgensteinian kind of notion of pragmatics is another connection that could be made here. The third paradigm is that of technological performance, in the sense that we might talk about the performance of a car or a computer or something like that. Mackenzie notes that there's much less critical literature about this mode of performance, although, as R.L. Rutsky argues in his book High Tech, the notion of high performance is hugely prevalent in contemporary culture and can be used as a lens through which to view the underlying logic of modernity and beyond. Interestingly, Rutsky suggests that the notion of high tech functions as an aesthetic category as much as a technical one. This illustrates how the different performance paradigms that Mackenzie identifies create kind of interference patterns as they mesh with each other. Bearing this in mind, I want to think again about the relations between the performances of Athey's automatic writing machine and Turing's abstract machine. Turing takes a scientific approach and attempts to clarify the question by designing a test that is controlled and repeatable, and fitting the question to the test rather than the other way around. In this sense, he situates the performance of his abstract machine in the paradigm of technological performance. The nature of the test also places the human and computer in competition with each other, thereby asking each speaker, as it were, to perform in an organisational sense. However, by making the criterion of his test the effective imitation of a human, he essentially asks his machine to enact a performance that is quasi-theatrical, inasmuch as the machine is given the task of acting as if human. You can view this as a cultural performance, which itself contains an aesthetic dimension. Moreover, the criterion of imitation means that, although Turing attempts to use a scientific approach to overturn the philosophical presupposition that thought properly belongs to the substantive subject, his pragmatic definition of thinking as effective deployment of language, pragmatic use of language, continues to index the human as its ultimate reference point. Thus, he effectively leaves the philosophical subject intact to function as the concealed but dominant term in this comparative relation. Larouard suggests that such a comparative approach to the question of thinking machines, quote, supposes a human whose functionality the machine imitates to the nearest degree. This is an interiority of consciousness that's then spread out in space. Or instead, this machinic and algorithmic immanence comes first, and it's consciousness or our concept of consciousness that imitates the machine, end quote. In either case, he argues, one finds oneself turning a kind of vicious circle, which does nothing to shift our fundamental understanding of what it means to think, and by extension, to speak. I've suggested that Athey's theatrical work fits into the paradigm of cultural performance. Yet his automatic writing machine also conforms in many ways to the computational logic outlined by Turing, having facilities for storage, pens, paper, typewriters, execution in the performers, and control in the protocols that govern the parameters of the performer's actions. In this sense, it can also be seen to perform in a technological fashion, albeit a resolutely low-tech one. Like the Turing test, Gifts of the Spirit places two modalities of language production next to each other, the subjectively produced memoir and the machinically produced automatic writing. Excuse me. However, Athey's intention is not to make them compete to perform in the organisational sense, but rather to use the juxtaposition of the two texts to generate a new layer of sense that neither contains when considered in isolation. Hence, the two modes of language production do not cancel each other out, but rather exist in a kind of complementary constellation. Nevertheless, the autobiographical material acts as a kind of source text and an anchor, which the automatically generated writing supplements. Thus, I would argue that the subject, the human subject, remains the primary source of linguistic meaning here, too. Langlois' non-philosophical method entails taking a philosophically constituted object and viewing it as unilaterally related to a radical immanence, which is axiomatically posited as the real cause of thought. I propose that by taking aspects from each of the language-generating machines I've discussed, we can sketch out the workings of this new, more imminent vision. Like Turing, Narrowell uses an abstract mode of theorization that constructs and describes hypothetical models. But Turing's mathematical fictions, which articulate the principles for constructing thinking machines that might exist in the future, do so by evacuating the notion of experience from thinking. Whereas Narrowell turns abstraction to a different purpose, deploying it to modulate our understanding of the transcendental relation between thought and its object, thus constructing a theoretical apparatus that is supposed as real in an untimely now and allows us to see the thinking speaking subject through a new lens. Thus he takes a scientific approach that is in some ways similar to Turing's, but he deploys it at a transcendental level. Just as Turing refused the validity of the question, can machines think, from the outset, Narrowell suspends the authority of philosophy to determine the real essence of thought as a first principle. But rather than sidestepping the experience of thinking, he posits that subject to thought that is nothing but the imminent lived experience of thinking, devoid of any objectivizable predicates. Using this logic, we can change the vector of thought. So that rather than beginning with a philosophically determined subject of speech and then trying to adjust it to accommodate speaking machines, we instead provide a kind of flat plane on which to stage the manifestation of linguistic meaning, according to the principle that the experience of speaking is radically performative, that the performance of language constitutes the experiential identity of the speaking or thinking subject. Interestingly, by using an axiomatic method to effectuate this imminent vision, the results remain strictly hypothetical. The imminent subject experience is supposed as real, but only in the as-if mode of a theatrical performance. This entails a scientific deployment of fiction that is no longer mathematical, as with Turing, but rather what Larrewell calls a philo-fiction, which in this case consists of using transcendental notion of the computer as the lens through which to view the philosophical problematic of the origin of linguistic meaning. With this conjugation of science and theatre, we see different performance paradigms begin to collapse into each other, but without losing their differences from each other at the same time. I will conclude by suggesting that Athey's performance piece can assist us in visualising what the outcome of this conjugation is. I've suggested that his juxtaposition of two modes of language production in a single performance goes some way towards manifesting materially a non-philosophical vision of the subject of language. By looking again at this piece through the axiomatic apparatus that suspends the primacy of the philosophical subject, we place the two modes of speech on the same level, viewing them as equally imminent. Thus, the human subject of speech simulates the speaking machine, but without sacrificing the experience of thinking or speaking. In this way, the depersonalization of the memoir text is radicalized, estranging the subject of speech from all determinate predicates. Such an underdetermined and radically performative subject experience opens the possibility of imminent speaking machines.
Thank you.
I wanted to thank Hannah again, and she set up the afternoon of performances brilliantly. Do we have a couple of quick questions in the room before we move to performances? Yes, Mark. Do you need a microphone, Mark? You may need, I think you need a microphone as well, so I don't want to project.
Hi. In the Fuku's Hermeneutics of the Subject, he talks about spiritualization as a pairedness of philosophical truths, that they cannot be just dished out maybe like sweets or something, that one has to be prepared for this kind of language, this kind of understanding. Am I correct? Am I thinking in the similar, correct thinking that you're perhaps suggesting maybe something like Ron's performance, or Ethan's performances, can somehow be a preparedness for this very difficult, complicated, complex philosophical understanding as a performance, as a performance piece? Is it some way? Is spiritualization scare quotes?
Yeah.
But as a preparation for receiving
absolutely.
This very complicated, complex.
I mean, what I sort of tried to do today was avoid, as I mentioned at the beginning, like Laravel's writing is just so utterly weighed down with jargon that it's really impenetrable. But he does make an interesting kind of proposition in his work around non-standard aesthetics, where he proposes that you design a matrix as a kind of transcendental framework by which you kind of cross aesthetics and philosophy through each other, in order to sort of bring about this underdetermination of certain authorities that philosophy, as he describes it, has, gives itself, as it were. He also proposes that art on its own and in its practice doesn't sort of have a way of necessarily doing this critique. It has to be an arrangement that kind of superposes the two things. But I do think that it's quite useful to think through. You know, I do think, I mean, I found that piece quite a kind of profound experience of really, it was a very sensuous experience of what machinic writing could be. And I think that actually Laravel's essay on the transcendental computer, part of its aim is to refute some of the interpretations of his non-philosophical method that see it as a fully automatic kind of thought, to reassert that there must be sensuous experience as part of this, but not sensuous in a material way. That necessarily, but sort of sensory thinking experience. So, yes, I mean, when I was thinking through the Turing test on the one hand, Athey's automatic writing on the other hand, I would say that Athey's piece is closer to Laravel's notion of what it would be. But in the end, you would arrive at it by taking on board the kind of axiomatic framework, saying, okay, we'll accept that you can suspend this philosophical authority. And then you look at Athey's piece, and it's right there. It's actually enacted it, but that depends on assuming the posture to view it in that way. So partly.
It's a high.
Yeah.
Do we have one more question, or should we move to performances? Okay. I think in that case, I'd like to thank you again, because